Good morning. Today we will complete our discussion on handling data on disk files. We have already seen how we use files both implicitly and explicitly. Implicitly, we use files as streams of bytes coming from keyboard using cin, because cin always operates upon stdin, which is a default file pointer given by the operating system. Similarly, cout operates upon stdout, which is the default file pointer given by the operating system dot program. There is another file pointer called stderr. We have not used that very much. Later I will indicate how it is used. These are all implicit usage of files. Observe that these are all text files. So you read or write data in character strings. Typically, individual lines are terminated by new line characters and different values are terminated by one or more blanks or white spaces. We have also seen that we can explicitly open files, and we have the capital F-I-L-E as the type which declares a file pointer. We can associate that file pointer with any specific file on the disk by using the fopen command, and subsequently we have seen how we can use fscanf, fprintf, fgets, etc. to read strings, write strings and interpret values in a text file. However, we have always commented that when we keep very large amount of data on the disk, we would like to directly access a desired piece of information from the disk rather than sequentially scanning for that desired piece of information starting from the first byte of the file. It is in this context that we need to look at the direct access to C++ files. We have seen very briefly that direct access is feasible, but how do we exactly use it for our applications is not clear. In the process, we shall also revisit the data management basics. Last time, very briefly, we had looked at the entity model and we had said that a class of entities, such as a class of students, would be represented by a set of attributes, and that attribute values will define a particular student in that class uniquely. We had identified attributes such as name, roll number, marks obtained, courses registered for, hostel, room, etc. We had also seen that this model for an entity can be translated first into a tabular form of information and later in the form of a disk file, where on the disk you would create a file containing information about all entities of the class. There you will store information about a single entity in a record, and each record would have fields containing values of different attributes. So records and fields is the basic notion inside this file corresponding to our information model. Essentially then we are looking for ways in which we can directly access a record, perhaps directly access a field in a record, or directly access a record, get it in the memory and process various fields, and possibly update information inside that record in the same place where the original record was on the disk. For locating such records, we need the notion of a primary key. We had seen in our sample entity model for student that roll number is such a primary key. However, we observed that roll number is a character string and therefore represents far more number of possible values as possible primary key values, out of which only 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 values will be valid values. On the other hand, we know that on the disk, a file can be treated as an array of bytes. And just as we can index an array to go to any particular byte in the array, similarly we can go to a specified position on the disk and access one or more bytes from that position. What it means is that A direct access is visible only if I can specify the numerical position of a particular character on the disk. Which means that if we use something like a serial number, it will be much easier to go to a corresponding record on the disk. Now, in real life, primary keys are not such well-formed integer numbers. They are usually character strings such as roll number or a part number in an inventory system or a train ID in a train reservation system, whatever. If at all we have to directly access a record which is uniquely identified by a primary key which is non-numeric, then we must find a way to map such non-numeric keys onto an appropriate position value which is a numeric value on the disk. This mapping is usually created using an index table. Index tables themselves could be very large, so the index tables can be stored on files and these are called index files. We'll discuss these issues later very briefly. Currently, we are going to illustrate the use of direct access to our records and fields, assuming that the primary key is numeric and that there is a simple method of arithmetic calculation using which the primary key can be converted into a position on the disk. There is some recapitulation of what we had briefly discussed when we described the files on disk. A file on disk is a stream of bytes. The file itself is pointed to by a file pointer, say file star FP or something. Additionally, for every disk file, the operating system maintains a current position. We may briefly call it as POS. This is very much like an index to an array. Once we find out that these sequence of bytes can be considered to be an array of bytes, then like an array in our program, we declare char, say, A 500. That means we have 500 bytes of information. Now by using an index, say I, setting I to 25 and referring to AI will mean I am referring to 25th byte. In exactly the same fashion, there is an invisible position indicator or position index called POS. Well, POS is my name I have used. There is no such name that you can explicitly use for the position. This is invisible. This position pointer for every file is maintained by the operating system. It is not visible to you, but you can set its value. And you can test its value. So that is what is important. Now, there is a function called FC which sets the position POS for access. Ordinarily, when you open a file, this position pointer or position index is always set at the beginning. So opening of the file, the 0th byte of the file, observe that it is an array in true similarity. That means the first byte of the disk file is actually called by the operating system as 0th byte and the last byte is called the size of bytes minus 1. There is a size of the file that you can get just as you can get string length. So as I mentioned, POS is invisible to us. However, POS can be set by us. Now how do we set the POS? We would like to set the POS at any desired position. So we will have a numerical value. This numerical value which we give as a parameter to fseek function is given always as a displacement. And this displacement can be specified relative to any one of the three positions on the file. The first position is called the file beginning. And that is indicated by a global parameter called seek underscore set. So when you include IOStream, this variable is defined. Seek underscore set means relative to beginning, whatever position I give, whatever number of bytes I give, move the POS pointer to that one. I can also set it relative to the current position, which is specified by seek underscore cur or current. I can also specify relative to the end position for seek end. Obviously, in such case, the displacement should be negative in order to access a meaningful byte on the disk. Now, just as I can set index for an array by saying I equal to something, j equal to something and use that. The corresponding way of setting this first index for a file is only F6 statement. So once again I would like to remind you that this POS is invisible to you. You cannot say POS equal to something. You cannot declare POS as a variable and say POS is equal to 5434 byte. That is not permitted. The invisible variable is set by the F6 statement. So every time you want to do a read or write operation, remember, read or write operation will always happen at the correct position of such an invisible byte. So before every read or write operation, you must use F6 to set the pointer properly. When you execute a read or write command by using functions fread and fwrite, these are different from cin, cout, they are different from fscanf, fprintf. Those input-output statements operate upon text files and extract individual values. You can even read a line by using a get a statement or a get line statement function, as we can see later, from text file. This is not like that. This particular fread or fwrite is capable of reading or writing a specified number of bytes. So it does not matter what those bytes contain. They may contain text, they may contain binary, integer, data, floating point, representation, whatever. So consequently, there is no notion of a white space being skipped or a new line character ending something. If you say read 20 bytes, it will read exactly 20 bytes from this position onwards. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 20 bytes. That's it. And those 20 bytes will be given to you. Where will you keep them? Obviously, you will keep them in a buffer. Traditionally, such a buffer is declared as a char array. But it could be a structure, it could be an integer variable, whatever one. Because whatever has been written in the disk will be read. And whatever is there in the memory will be written. There is no translation, no change, no format difference, etc., etc., that happens in the fread or fwrite statement. There is one more thing that happens when you execute these statements. Every such operation advances this invisible pointer by as many bytes as you have read or written. This makes sense because quite often you might want to read all the records of a file. In which case, when you open the file, the POS is set here. When you first issue a command fread with so many bytes, say 100 bytes, it will read 100 bytes. Automatically, the position is advanced by the operating system to the next byte position. So if you issue another fread without doing F6, it will read next 100 bytes from this position. And so on. This makes sense because you can sequentially access a file which is otherwise meant for direct access. However, if you want to update a record, for example, at this position, you have read 20 bytes. Now you want to modify those 20 bytes in the memory and rewrite those 20 bytes here. Say, for example, marks in the midsem are recorded here. It's a float value. Now the marks have been updated because of re-evaluation. So obviously you would like to change the marks of a particular student. Exactly how do we reach a particular student records, we shall see through example. But assuming that these are the bytes which I want to rewrite, then after saying fread, say these 20 bytes, if I issue an fwrite after modifying the values, the writing will happen subsequent to 20 bytes because the POS has moved forward. Consequently, if you want to rewrite a particular set of bytes, you must bring this POS pointer back to this position. That means you must reissue an fseek. You can reissue an fseek by giving exactly the same positioning for fseek that you did for reaching here. Or alternately, you can reissue an fseek relative to the current position which would have been here by giving a negative value which will bring back to these 20 bytes or whatever. There are multiple ways of doing it. What we shall be doing is, we shall be seeing some examples which illustrate how do we use direct access files for such purposes. To illustrate the need for data to be maintained in form other than text form, I have taken the same example that we had seen earlier. This actually creates an artificial output file from the input lines of text which contain your mid-semester marks data. You all remember this? We have done this. So we have seen, for example, that I would have a serial number, comma, roll number, comma, name, comma, batch number, comma, marks, 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 etc. This was the kind of comma separated field value that I got from a spreadsheet in which this data was entered. And we had seen that we can create an output file containing exactly the same text lines but padded with 5 stars at the beginning, artificial. It does not make any sense, but just to illustrate that not only I can use cin and cout, I can use files to read complete lines, and I can use files to write complete lines. And I can write any lines, not necessarily what I have read. So we had illustrated it by seeing this. So essentially then we have a file which contains this kind of data. Observe that although it is a text file, I can actually open it for import and directly access any byte position here also. However, we observe that the lines are not of the same length, because the name may be smaller in some case, larger in another case. The marks in some case may be 2.5, in another case it may be 1. And therefore, the length of a line is not same as length of another line. Although the values of the attributes that are maintained in every line are exactly same attributes for every student. Okay. For every student, we have a serial number, roll number, name, batch, etc. But the value is so different that the total length of bytes is different. Assume that I still try to see what happens when I directly access records here. This is an illustrative program. So this program, I have not given the other paraphernalia. But it opens the file, directly accesses bytes at position 0, 182, 364, etc. Why 182, 364? These are arbitrary numbers. But let us say that I have found out that the longest line was 182 bytes. So I presume that if there were fixed length lines, then they will all be 182 bytes long. So let us see what happens when I read 0th byte position, 182nd byte position, 364th byte position, etc., etc. And just to illustrate the direct access, I have decided that I will read and print 20 characters at each position. So the objective here is not to do any meaningful operation, but just to illustrate that direct access is feasible even in case of text file. So let us see how this program proceeds. I will just say output which says arbitrary position. Long int file pause. This file pause resembles the pause pointer that I indicated in the previous slide, but it is not same. This file pause is an integer variable in my program. The capital pause was a hidden pointer used by the operating system. But since I have to give a displacement for seeking a position, that displacement has to be specified as a numeric value. I can specify an absolute value, I can specify a variable. That variable is required to be long end. In most 32-bit computers, such as the ones which you use, for example, long int may still be 4 bytes long, just as an ordinary. However, in more self-respecting computer systems, you would have long int as 8 bytes, because you should be able to handle very large files. Okay. In any case, long int is the default declaration for such internal pointer, not pointer, but a position value that we mention. Notice what I want to do is, I want to read from arbitrary position and I want to read 20 bytes. Now, when I read 20 bytes arbitrarily from a text file, you will agree that there may not be any end of string or backslash zero implied. There is nothing like that in the text file. So, in order to ensure that when I read these bytes and try to print them, what is printed is a valid string, I artificially put this 20th element as backslash zero. Backslash zero means whatever is the remaining part of the string, there is definitely a backslash zero at the end. Remember, when I use get s or f get s, a backslash zero is inserted by the operation which reads that text, because it knows it is reading a text string. However, that is not so in direct access as I mentioned. So I insert this article. Now I open a file, I give a file name. If you recall, there was a program which we had seen earlier where file name was being read from the user, and that file name is what is being used here. I open this file for reading, so I just say R. This is the program. What it does is, for the relative position 0, 1, 8, 2, 3, 6, 4, etc., etc., I set up an iteration for 5 positions from 0 to less than some arbitrary value, say 1000, because I just want to illustrate the sample of direct access, and I increment that by 182 every day. Observe carefully the F6 statement. F6 in 5, comma, 5 pulse, comma, 0. That's the format. The 5 pointer here, the relative position by which I want to displace the current position, and 0 means seek set. I should actually use seek underscore set. I have used this 0 merely to illustrate that seek set, seek cut, and seek end have implicit internal values of 0, 1, and 2. In fact, in traditional C file systems, we use 0, 1, 2. Later on, as the language evolved, these are the global variables which are named for these purposes. So instead of this 0, I can as well write seek underscore set, and in fact, that is the right way of doing it. So what happens? When I give this FC, the internal file position is set with respect to beginning of the file to as many bytes as are indicated by file pointer. Effectively then, if I use such an F6 statement, file pause is almost same as the internal pause. But F6 is the only way of setting that pointer. Having set that pointer, I read 20 bytes from this. Observe the read statement. F read part record. This is the buffer. Observe that part record is a character string and it is 20 bytes long. This F read statement read blocks of bytes and it can read as many blocks as you want. The second specification says what is the size of that block. In this case, the size is 20 bytes. The third parameter says how many such blocks are to be read. Observe that if my buffer was large enough, I could read 5000 blocks of 20 bytes in one shot. So fread is a very powerful statement. In fact, you can, if your file is small and is well structured, it has fixed length records, you can read the entire file in one fread statement. If you know the number of records, entire in one shot, and you get assigned the pointer that you are pointing. So that is easily possible. However, in this particular case for illustration, we are just reading 20 bytes at this position. We are printing the file pause, which is our internal thing, the part record, which is the 20 bytes which we have read. Observe that part record is a valid string now because we have artificially inserted a backslash 0 in the 20th. What happens when I execute this program? So here are the execution results. Reading from arbitrary positions. 0, 1, 8, 2, 3, 6, 4 are the arbitrary positions. Okay? At 0th byte, I get the first 20 bytes of the record. Observe that the record was much bigger. In fact, it was, if I'm not mistaken, Joshi something something. Joshi has become Joss because I have artificially cut down that string to 20 bytes. Observe the next string, 182. It starts with 11, 0, etc. I think you can surmise that the first 11 must be a batch number of someone. Okay. Because there was no question which had 11 marks. And the subsequent 0, 2, 3 indicate that this must not be the total marks for a student. If you recall the values which are stored in the record. So this is an arbitrary 20 bytes from here. Specifically note what happens when you go to 364th byte. You have 0, 17.5 and then there is nothing, but on the next line you are getting there. What it means is that the new line character which existed in the text file is also read as one character. Remember, F read has no specific fancy for new line character, end of line character, end of string character, nothing. You just read those 20 bytes. So because there is a new line character, on the screen when you show a C out, you will go to the new line. Very clearly that is so because 17.5 is probably the sum of the marks obtained by a student and this is next. Next student again I print 5 stars, 6, not even the full roll number because the total number of bytes if you count including the new line character will be 20 bytes. Same thing happens at 546, a part of the name comes and something like this here. 728, you get again 0, 17, new line character, and this 910, this etc. So from a practical point of view, this exercise is not yielding any meaningful information. But we have understood how to set an internal position pointer of a file at any desired location and how to read from that location. If we want to convert this power into meaningful reads and writes, we'll have to take some decisions. So when is direct access meaningful? Direct access is meaningful only if I can access the complete record of an entity. Otherwise, it is not very meaningful. Further, direct access is meaningful not only if I can access the complete record of a person or an entity, but I can reach the beginning point of that record on the disk. So not only full record reading capability must exist, but ability to reach to a position of the beginning of that record also must exist. Clearly, these two requirements are satisfied if I decide while designing my file that look, I shall not write arbitrary text in the file representing information about people or entities, but I shall use fixed length records. A fixed length record is a record containing information about an entity always has so many bytes only, 100, 85, 73, 2154, whatever, a fixed number of bytes always. Obviously, if my fields within a record have variable length, then it is my responsibility to ensure that I convert all these variable values into a fixed length pattern and write those fixed length attributes juxtaposed against each other as a full record of a fixed length. If I do that, the first requirement is satisfied. That means whenever I can go to the beginning of that record, I can read exactly so many bytes and I have full record for that day. But how do I go to that position? That is where I need to have a position indicator. Once I have fixed length record and I know the length of the record, why I can know exactly fifth record will be where, 124th record will be where, 1000th record will be where, because I know each record occupies so many bytes. There are some consequences of this usage. One, there is no artificial delimiter is required. In text files, we have backslash n. In fact, we depend upon that backslash n to get one line of data. Just as we depend upon white spaces, blanks or tabs to differentiate between different values. When I have fixed length records, I don't need such artificial delimiters between records, such as new line character. I don't need artificial delimiters between field values. I don't need to separate one field from another field by either a comma or a blank. If, just as I fix the length of the record, I also fix the length of every field. In short, if I move from the realm of completely variable fields and variable records to a new realm of fixed length record and fixed length fields within that record, then I have an extremely nice ordered situation wherein, knowing the record length, I can actually go to the beginning of that record and read the complete record in one shot. Interpreting the values of fields within that record, of course, is my responsibility. And what I should ensure is, whatever the fixed length fields that I have decided upon are exactly written the way I have maintained them in memory, so that when I read that data back in the same memory definition of data structure, then I will directly get those values. Since these values need not be text, the values can be int, float, in fact, they can even be structure. And structure is an ideal organization for the information about an entity. Because in a structure, I can define separate components. Each component can be construed to be a field in my record. Each of these components will have fixed length. Even if you have an array of characters, which is a character string, still the declared dimension of that array will tell me so many bytes is what this field is. Using this notion then, I can meaningfully deploy the direct access to records. So imagine that for the students of a course, somebody declares such a structure, which is called a type student input. As I said, it's an abstract data type When I say struct student info is not a variable. I have to declare a variable separately, as we shall see in the example. I have an int serial number. Notice that as decided earlier, we will use a serial number as primary key because we still do not know how to translate a roll number into a position on that list. So we will use serial number to define a position. Char S roll 10, 9 character string. Char S name 40, name of the student. Int match, float marks 10, float dot marks. Char grade 3, remark, character 255. Notice that float marks 10 are not marks for individual questions and subparts in an exam. This is designed to represent the total performance record of a student in a course. So these same fields are allocated to store marks obtained in different evaluation types. So one 0th element may be marks obtained in quizzes. First element may be marks obtained in assignment. Second element may be marks obtained in mid-semester. Third element may be end semester. Fourth element may be project. Fifth element may be something else. Another element could be bonus, whatever one. You can imagine that these 10 represent not the normally required number of various evaluations. But rather than deciding that this course has 4 types of evaluation, that course has 6 types of evaluation, and changing the nature of the record, it is better to allocate additional fields. The idea is that if I further introduce in this a course code, then this record can be used by all courses and all teachers in the institute. This is generalized. When you design your files, I would expect you to apply this kind of logic to design Compose. The advantage of using a struct should be obvious. Once I define a variable, say struct student info S. Now that S is a variable which will be allocated memory. And how much memory? It will be allocated memory exactly equal to the size of this struct. So just the size of int is 4, size of float is 4. Size of struct is something, and that becomes so many bytes. Don't you have therefore a fixed length record now? Similarly, you can read those many bytes from the disk into a struct. And when you read that, automatically the bytes will fall into this sequence. And that means that separation of fields from the disk record is then handled automatically by the read and write statement. To illustrate this, I have considered another example, not of ordinary students, but of a larger dimension, also to illustrate, because this kind of record, how many students are there in IIT? 8,000 total. Now 8,000 records in a file, picking, I could store all of them in an array. To illustrate that there are situations where I cannot handle all records in memory, I have taken this example. This is a real life example. We are actually in the process of doing this work. There is a national mission for education through information and communication technology, which attempts to enhance the quality of education all across the educational system. IIT Bombay is embarked on a component of that national mission, which says enhancement of the quality in professional courses, engineering colleges. We are targeting engineering college teachers and students. Very roughly, the process is as follows. We decide on a core subject which is taught in most colleges to most students. Then we ask teachers to come and participate in a 2-week workshop. We prepare the lectures and the tutorials and the labs, not only in consonance with how we teach those courses here in IIT, but also taking into account how these courses are taught at various universities. Because university syllabi are different, question paper patterns are different. So our attempt is to tell these teachers that if you want to teach in the style in which you continue to teach, this is the material that you can use. However, if you wish to adopt something from IIT style of teaching, this is additional material. We engage them for 2 weeks, and all the recorded audio-video lectures, transcripts, all the tutorials, everything is later on released in open source so that people can use it. This open source material will be accessible to students, teachers, everybody. And this can be modified by teachers and used, that is the meaning of open source. Incidentally, the recording that are happening for CS101 course here will all go in the open source after it. Now, how do we, open source means what? Do we just put a web page and links just like home page here? The objective is not merely to give information, because access to information is not knowledge. If that were true, librarians would be the most knowledgeable people in the world. So, applying one's mind to that excess knowledge, discussing, learning, discovering new things is what is not. And therefore, we wish to set up subject-wise portals. The first portal will be coming up in this December on computer programming. The next portal will be coming up on database management system, which Professor Sudarshan is here heading. He will be conducting a workshop this December on database management. Now, these portals are meant to be used by whom? By all students, by all teachers, and even professionals. Imagine you pass out of an institution and you join, let's say, TCS or Infosys or whatever, or some company, and you still want to keep in touch with what is happening on this basic subject of programming. So you are a legitimate possible user. In fact, once I say open source, the information can be accessed by absolutely anybody in the world. However, we want to create discussion forums. We want to create collaborative groups so that these open source contents are perpetually enhanced by the interested people. People will contribute from this place, that place, different groups will come together. What should be the total number of members who may be accessing this portal either for this subject or that? Our estimation went like this. We first estimated the number of students who join engineering programs in the country every year. Any idea how many? About 6.5 lakh students join engineering courses every year. The total number of students studying engineering in a four-year program is roughly 2.5 million. This is only undergraduate students. You take the postgraduate students and you take the new colleges which are opening. Every day perhaps dozen colleges open. Soon some will start closing also, but that's a different story. There would be professionals who would be interested in joining. Therefore, we estimate that these portals would be used by about 5 million members. Now, you will agree that 5 million is a large number. It's not 5,000 students. 5 million students, teachers, working professionals. If they have to access, then I have to give them some access rights. Anybody who wants to read does not need access rights. It's an open source portal. But anybody who wants to contribute, then that person must be recognized by us. So there has to be a registration process, much like you do the registration when you join this institute. Apart from that registration, there will be additional information which at different pieces of points of time, the portal will keep collecting from the member. Some member says, I want to participate in the discussion forum on pointers in this subject. So there may be a separate group, group identity, etc. Just as you have groups in the Moodle, we'll have to create something like that. But to illustrate the use of direct access files, I have decided to construct an example which merely does the basic enrollment of these students, these teachers, and these professionals. So we have about 5 million records to be written. Now, initially, when I start the portal, there is 0%. So what I do? I create a file with 5 million IDs, which are some numbers that I give, enrollment number, etc., and some artificial information about their name, city, whatever, whatever. I decide that I must collect eventually from every member who joins. And I create such a file. Later on, when a particular person comes in and says, this is my name, and this is my city, then I would like to read that record directly and update that information. That is the objective of using direct access files here. We need software to create and maintain such file and associated file, not one file. Consider the IIT Bombay academic system, the academic information processing system, which has a large number of programs, does something like this for all the students' records here. But it does not have one file. It does not have one entity called student. It has several other entities. Course is an entity. Teacher is an entity. Hostel is an entity. In any significant information system, there would be about 15 to 20 different entities, main entities, and there could be artificial entities associated. the total number of attributes across these entities that a real life system will handle could range anywhere from 200 to 20,000. That is how the systems become very large and complex. Because you need programs to handle each one of these effects. Here is a program to create portal DB. Observe the comments. The comments say that this program creates artificial data for students, professionals and teachers numbering about 5 million who will be members of IIT Bombay Open Source Education Portal. The database file name is artificially set as Portal DB or Portal Database. Now, primary key. We artificially decide that each participant member shall be given a 9-digit enrollment number. The enrollment number to be a valid 9-digit number, it cannot start with 0. If it has to have 9 valid digits, it should start with 1. So consequently, we decide that the first enrolled person or member will have an enrollment number of 1 million. And then 1 million 1, 1 million 2, 1 million 3, etc. Up to 5 million additional enrollment numbers I would like to create this data. The file inputs are standard file inputs. The meat of the program starts with declaration of a structure to store these values. So look at the structure member info, the abstract data type as I mentioned. We have integer enrollment. Enrollment number starts with this. Char name 60. Name of the member, initially all star. Why? Because I don't have any real thing. So what I am doing is I am creating artificial 5 million records. The only real thing about it is the enrollment number, which is exact correct. All other information is artificial. City would be a 40 character long name. Well, for short for Pawai, I will just put P in the first position and put a backslash 0 there. I will artificially insert. Postal code, it's an integer, default is this. Character, category 2, a 1 character code for category. Why 2? Because the character should be followed by backslash 0 so that when I print it, it's a valid string. Observe the categories. S for student, which I say is default, which means initially I will insert S. T for teacher, T for professional. Why O for other? Parents is one suggestion. I have a better suggestion. Suppose there is a philanthropist, say Ratan Tata announces that this is an excellent exercise started by IIT Bombay. I want to give a donation of 10 crore rupees. I say, please become a member. Are you a student? No. Can you write programs? No. Are you a teacher? No. Sorry, I can't make you a member. Would that be a right way to say that? Say, of course you are welcome. You are other. Give 10 crore rupees. That's the right thing. The point that I am trying to make is, should not be lost in the humor. The point that I am trying to make is, whenever you model any information system, you will invariably go by the limited thinking that you will apply to the problem. So what is visible to you? You will put only those characteristics and those attributes and those possible values. So when the premise of the program or the whole purpose is to say students, professionals and teachers, you would invariably end up saying only these three possible values. It does not make really much difference because I can put any one character here and I have A to Z. The point is, if you have initially identified the possible values by extending your imagination of who others could benefit, what else can be done, then you will get a better design of your information structure.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, in means postal code and enrollment,
yes.
We have user type int.
Yes.
But int has maximum value of the order 37,000 and something.
37,000? No, no. Int is 4 bytes. Short int is 2 bytes. So short int will bomb if you have postal code. So I think either North India or South India will be omitted if you use short int. So int is okay, no problem. And enrollment number is actually 2 to the power 31 minus 1 is the largest number. It's a fairly large number, so don't worry. Besides, this program have actually run it, tested it, so it works. Notice this file, pointer declaration, file star out file, char file name 30, although I am not going to use the file name. This is the program. Read this very carefully because various lines relate to both the formation of information of the structure and writing data. Struct member info member. So this is the variable actually. Member is the actual variable. And member.city, member.postal code, etc. is the way to refer to the elements as we have seen. Rec size. Remember, we want to write a fixed length record. The rec size is the size of this structure, member info. So this abstract data type which I have defined as struct member info, its size will be the rec size. Just for the sake of knowing, I print it out. Now I initialize the default field values for the record. So observe that I put star in the name, I put a \0 here, I put member.city.0 as p, and I put member.city1 as \0. I'm just putting one character, artificial name of basic. Postal code is an integer number, which is assigned here. Category is assigned as student, because that is the default category. And the remark is put as blank. So I put all the blanks here and put the \0 there. I open the output file here. Notice the fopen statement. Outfile is a file pointer. Outfile equal to fopen, portal db, wb. This is important. WB means write and B means binary. So it's not a text. If you don't write B, it will be assumed to be a text. So we are all set to create records in the file.
Why do we need 2 bytes for a category?
Why do I need 2 bytes for a category? Is because when I get the category in my memory from the file, I would like to, without processing it, print it as a string or treat it as a string.
So can you?
If I just declare as char1, then I will not be able to treat it as a string. It is a matter of choice. You can. His question is, why do I need an array of 2 elements? If it's a 1-character code, I need not put that \0. The point that I am trying to make is, unless explicitly required, you would invariably use strings to represent even individual characters. So all char arrays will be actually string, and there cannot be a valid string internally unless there is a \0 at it. So if I juxtapose a \0 after a category, when I read the category, for example, member.category is a string now, I can use C out member.category, it will print it correctly. I can later on, as we shall see, in the string type, I can concatenate strings. I can operate upon strings. And the string operation is exactly identical for any string, because every string is assumed to be a \0 at end. If you know very surely that you will never treat any individual character as string, you are most welcome to use char just as a single type. No problem. So it will take 1 byte less on the store. So please remember this point, that if you are very sure that you are going to use 1 character, you can actually declare that as a char variable, which is part of your member. Not only that, we shall be seeing very soon bit fields. Actually, C++ permits you to access individual bits, define individual bit fields and access individual fields. Even individual bit fields, say bit 3, so 3-bit field can be defined. The total rake size, however, will depend upon the actual memory allocation, because memory allocation is required to begin at what is known as word boundary. So a 3-bit field cannot then end and the 4th bit onwards be assigned to some other full byte. That is not possible. So the memory allocation will be different, but you need not worry about it. So whatever is the memory allocation, the rake size will get you the total size of the record, and reading and writing will happen accordingly. So he has a valid point. There is no need. It's a matter of choice. And as I said, the reason for this choice is I like to treat all character things as string. But wherever there is a single character and you are sure, there is no harm, you can use the single character. All right. But this is all assignment edition. I have opened this file. Observe the error checking. If for some reason this file cannot be opened, for example, I don't have right permissions in the directory in which I am trying to open the file, or there is no disk space, whatever. In which case, the out file will return a null pointer. This F open statement will return a null pointer. Invariably, after opening, closing, even reading, writing, you are supposed to do an error check. So this is an error check. If out file is null, I output some error message and return one directly here. There are different sides of programming. One in which you say, if out file is not null, then do all this. All this is rest of your program. Consequently, you are required to indent every line of your program because it is part of this if. I prefer this type, that if there is a problem, I return immediately. The rest of the program can follow at the same indentation level. But again, it's a matter of choice. Both approaches are, of course, correct. This is the meat of the program which attempts to write 5 million records in the database file. I have to write 5 million records, so I set up a count. Count equal to 0, count less than 5 million, count plus plus. Member.enrollment. This is the only field which I have not given a value yet. All other default fields have been given value. And what is the value I am giving? Since the first enrollment number has to be 1 million, next 1 million 1, 1 million 2, I simply add count to 1 million. Notice that I can use the reverse logic to extract the position from a given enrollment number. I simply subtract 1 million from it and I will know the position or the count of records. The record number, not really position, but the record. Anyway, that we shall see later. Having set member.enrollment equal to this, which is an integer number, and all other fields have been set, my member record is ready to be written. I will print sample enrollment every 5 million records, 5 lakh records, just for the sake of confirming that data is correctly written to the disk. Because outputting every enrollment number for verification means 5 million numbers will be displayed on the screen. And that display will take longer than what it takes to write on the disk. So this is just a, once I test the program, I can simply remove these lines. I don't need this. What am I doing in this iteration? The correct statement that I am using is fwrite and member. Remember, member is a structure and to functions, I must point pointers. I must set pointers. I don't expect fwrite to change the value of member. Fread will change it because fread will read the byte there. But the method for function call is always a pointer. If you don't give a pointer, there will be a mismatch. Well, the way the fwrite function is defined, it expects a pointer, not the actual member value. Reg size, that is the size, how many bytes I want to write, how many units of records, only one unit at a time. And this is the out file pointer. Once I do that, the invisible file pointer will move reg size bytes away. Next time when I execute this fwrite, it will write the number of bytes with a different enrollment number in next position, next position, next position. That's it. Whether I execute it 5 million times or 1 million times or 100 times, this simple loop will write all the records in my file. So my file is now ready for usage. I will close that file and I just give an error message. So this is pretty straightforward. Let us very quickly look at how I will access information in this file for a given enrollment. This is the output of the file creation program. Nothing great about it. I have here the count 0, 5 lakh, 10 lakh, etc. And these are the enrollment numbers. So this output file has been created. I have now a program to read the portal database file. So purpose of this and associate programs, as I said, is to illustrate the direct access file. This program continues to use the same structure. So I have the struct member info, file definition. The difference is now, I declare this all right, I calculate the reg size. I open the file for reading. So I say in file is equal to F open, portal DB and RB. So R stands for read and B stands for bind. Notice that the same physical file can be opened once for reading, once for writing, and as we shall see in the next program for update, it can be opened for changing value. again I check, I just print the information that I'm reading, the records, etc. The actual reading, what I want to do is I want to set up an infinite iteration. In that infinite iteration, I want you to give me your enrollment number and just display the information that I have. So this is the infinite iteration. Do while something. Something is given enrollment number greater than you. Actually, as we shall see the logic, I could have even said do while true. Because this is an infinite iteration I am setting up. Why? Because first time I come inside the iteration, I ask for an enrollment number, collect the given enrollment number, and if that enrollment number is negative, I break. That means I get out. Why am I using do while rather than while something? Is because do while will guarantee at least one execution of the iteration. So I don't have to artificially read a given enrollment number first and at the end of the iteration again read it for the next iteration, etc. It's a simpler mechanism. When I am absolutely sure that I can break the iteration. The break is a powerful statement, it bypasses all of this, bypasses while and comes out. Break means get out. If I want to break only out of the present iteration and go back for the next iteration, I should use the word continue. So continue and break are differentiated like that for logical implementation. Now look at what I am doing. Given enrollment number, I subtract 1 million from it. What do I get? I get the record number that I want to read. It will be 0th record, 1st record, 2nd record, 5th record, whatever. I multiply that by rec size. I get the file to read. So I get where exactly that record is located in the disk file. I do an FC with that file position. And I say from the beginning, go to file pos number of bytes. File pos has been correctly calculated. So, on a given enrollment number, in one shot I have got the file position. In the second shot, I have set the disk pointer there, internal disk pointer. Now when I say F read and member, rec size 1, read one record. How many bytes? Rec size 1. All the bytes which are there on the disk will come and sit in the memory occupied by that structure, which is member. So automatically member.enrollment, member.this, member.that, whatever, whatever, all fields will be populated automatically. No scanf, no %d, no nothing is required. No scene for different components. In one shot you get the record. Just for confirmation, I am saying record position is at by so and so, the file position is so and so, and the enrollment number, category and postal code is so and so. So this is the iteration at the end of which I close the file and return. This is the sample output. So I am giving an enrollment number of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I am printing the record position. You will observe that this is obtained by subtracting 1 million from it and multiplying it by the rec size. So this is the actual byte position at which this record is found. That record is read in the member. I am merely printing the member component. So I am saying enrollment number is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Record position is at byte so and so. What I am printing is enrollment number, status and postal code. Observe that only thing that was different in different records was the enrollment number. This enrollment number is not the given enrollment number. This I am printing as member.enrollment, means whatever has been read from the disk. So it is a confirmation that yes, what I have read is correct. I am giving another enrollment number and then I am giving minus 1 to stop. This is simple. Now I want to change. I want to change contents of F1. So let's say several 20 lakh students and 1 lakh teachers and 1,000 professionals have enrolled, they have been given enrollment number. And somebody changes the status. Let's say I was a student, I had enrolled as a student. Now I have passed out and I have joined as a teacher in some other college. I would like to come to the portal authorities and say, look, my status is student, please change it to teacher. I should be able to do that. I'll ask you, what is your enrollment number? Read the record. Modify the status and rewrite the record. That's the simple thing that I want to do. This program illustrates that. All of this is straightforward, struct member info, rec size, etc., etc. I open the int file. The thing to be noted here is the way I open it. The parameter or this particular flag is RB plus. RB means read and binary. Plus means read and also write. This means the file is being opened for update. It is my responsibility to update properly. If I make a mistake in that five position, then I can, please remember the five position indicator is treated very much like an index. If you have declared an array of 100 bytes, and if your index is 124, it will write to 124th position. Similarly, if you have created a disk file for 1000 records with so much length, and by mistake, your file position is some 1 million record onwards, when you close the file, you will suddenly find the file has become very large. There is nothing in between, but that byte is written there. And the file remembers, the operating system remembers that there was something written here, something written. So you have to be very careful with the positions that you maintain there. Here is the program, exactly the same style as reading, except that I am reading an update. Observe how it is done. I get an enrollment number, if it is negative, I get out. Now I calculate the file pause exactly as I am, and I read. Fseek in file pause and fread add member. So far so good. I print that information, member enrollment, category, postal code. Now I want to change the category to teacher and update the record. So this is how I do it. This again is the main slide of this program. Look at what I am doing. Member.category has been read. Whatever it is, I want to change it to teacher, so I am putting it at T. And of course, I am putting this at \0. I mean not because that \0 would have been there anyway. Now, what I have to do? Please remember, go to the previous statement. When I say fseek here and fread, at this fseek, my file pointer would have been pointed to the beginning of this record. After fread, the operating system has moved that file position pointer further by one record size. If I say F right now, the modified record will get written, overwriting the next fellow's record. So what I should do? I should bring the pointer back. And to bring the pointer back, there are multiple ways of doing that. Here, I am saying fseek in file minus rec size seeker. This is a perfectly valid statement. That means with respect to the current position, whatever it is, seeker is not the current position by this. Seeker is a flag whose value is 1. Seek set is 0, seeker is 1, seek end is 2. It is merely a flag which is passed out to that function. The file position pointer is internally maintained by OS. All that I am saying is, with respect to the current position, bring back the position to one record size. Because that is where I had read the previous record. So I bring that back. This is one way of repositioning the pointer. And I write this member. After writing this member, modified member, I want to verify whether I have written correctly. So what is the best way of verifying? Read that record again and print it out to check. How do I read that record again? Even the write statement has further advanced that. Every read or write advances the position. So I have to bring it back. This is another way of bringing it back. FC in file pause seek underscore set. This was the original method that we used. With respect to the beginning, whatever is my file pause, go to that part. Read this again. And then record position, etc. Key point to remember, every read statement will advance the position by one record. If you want to rewrite, you have to bring it back. There are two ways of doing it. One, with respect to the current position, go back one rec size. Provide it again. Another, with respect to the beginning, give the position that you have already calculated. Either way will work. This is the output of the update program. So it says updating records of this data. It collects enrollment number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Record position is at this byte. And it prints the original record that I have read. Enrollment number, data student, postal code. Record position is at byte. This is, after I have updated, I am reading it again. So notice that I have got correctly. The fact that the record has been updated is indicated by this printout. This S has become T. So that means status has changed. Notice that using this, you can use it to maintain any kind of file system, any kind of record system. Because now you know how to define a fixed length record with various components. Now you know how to write full records and how to read full records. And of course, managing information within a record, which is a structure, is child's play, because every structure element, structure dot, that structure variable dot that element, is like a variable, which is an integer, float, character, character string, or individual character, as our friend pointed out. Either can handle all. Is that clear? With this, we end the discussion on file and record management and information management. I already told you that printf and scanf details, you should be able to read and use them in your program. There is another program, I will not discuss this, but you can read this program. These slides will be on the machine. What this does is, it merely shows one way of extracting fields from comma separated fields. We have seen this briefly. We have seen how we extract, let us say, the batch number or name. But this one does it by extracting various pieces of information. I had actually written this as a precursor to another powerful function in the C++ library called strtop, or the tokenizer function. The extraction of tokens from a string, from a character string, is something which is very often required. All compilers actually do that when they read your program. So that is a powerful function which can, in iterative fashion, successively go to the next delimiter, such as comma is a delimiter. So it can successively extract information between two commas and give that information to you as a character string, which you can then convert. This is a precursor to that. Here, the commas are explicitly checked. So I have line case not equal to comma, do this, etc., etc. This program is just one way of implementing information extraction. Since we have done that already, I will just leave this for you for a data read. So this is the program which extracts parts of the string containing serial number, their name, etc., etc. Just one thing to be noted, if I were to read the name, for example, or roll number, which is a character string, I must not have a blank in between. So for example, if I want to read the name using cin statement, then the first blank will terminate the reading. Whereas if I extract characters completely till the next comma, I will get the full name. So that's the only important point here. So this is just an example. This is one record. The number of characters in line are 65. Serial number is 1. Roll number is this. Name is this. Batch number is this, etc., etc. You can read the program and relate to this output. But I will also put, or maybe I'll briefly discuss the strtok function. It's a very useful and a very powerful function to extract information from a text line which has field values delimited by specific symbols, comma, blank, tab, whatever. Okay. This is the last slide and perhaps the most important slide. There has been a delay in posting additional project ideas. I regret that and I am sorry. What happened is, my right-hand man and a colleague, co-instructor in this course, Nagesh Karmali, fell seriously ill last week. He's the one who used to handle all postings on the Moodle for assignments, weekly, lab handouts, etc. He was compiling the project list idea. But in the hustle bustle of treating him, we all forgot that he was the one who was to put it. We have packed him off to Goa after he has become all right, but there has been a delay. Consequently, most of you did not have the benefit of the other possible choices for doing the course project. Many of you would have thought of some course project. Some of you might not have yet decided. And therefore, since the list was put up only last night, I am extending the first stage submission from 19th to 24th midnight, that is Sunday. Consequently, the sample viva for two students from each batch will happen on Tuesday, Wednesday of the subsequent week. This is a breather for the first stage submission. However, there is no change in the deadline for Tuesday submission. These deadlines remain. Now, unfortunately, most of you have not made any submissions. Yesterday, when I said that this is not correct, that submission deadlines are submission deadlines, and why have you not submitted? I got 3 submissions by 1 o'clock midnight last night. After after midnight. One of them was 12 before 12 midnight, another was 11 minutes past 12, and the third one was about 1 o'clock or something. Only three submissions, and that too when I reminded that we should have submitted. However, I had told that batch, and I am telling you this for this batch also, that I am extending the weekly submission deadline just this once. And that deadline is today, Wednesday midnight. So, can I know why you did not submit on Tuesday midnight? So that was an agreed deadline, and all deadlines are defined to be hard deadlines, such as their body. I would like to know why you did not submit. Okay. No, just one second. I suppose that there will be at least some batch leaders or the team leaders of some batches here present. Can you raise your hands? Now suddenly batch leaders don't want to be identified. A much larger number than what I see here. Okay. So why is it that Tuesday submission did not occur? Okay. So let's understand one thing. I will take just 3 or 4 minutes more, but this is perhaps an extremely important declaration, announcement and clarification. And you must appreciate the objective. The weekly deadlines are supposed to let us know how much work a team has done in a particular week. As I had said, you should ideally form a batch directory. Under that batch directory, 3 team directories. Under each team directory, sub-directories for individual members. You will continue to work on your project on your independent machine. But whenever your program is done for the week, to whatever extent, you are expected to put that source code in that sub-directory of yours. Whenever you complete a documentation, whenever you complete some write-up of some idea, you are supposed to put it there. The only thing we don't want is actual executables. They don't make sense. Now these were to be put in your directory, and a single tar file was supposed to be submitted. That single tar file was supposed to be submitted on the Moodle, as also a mail was to be sent to your lab TA and to me. So yesterday people said there is no Moodle link. Why? If there is no Moodle link, the lab TA's email ID is available, my email ID is available. The point is, are you going to do these submissions because I am telling you to do these submissions, or are you going to do these so that you yourself as a group understand how important it is for weekly record maintenance, so that you know an important aspect of teamwork and project work of this kind? I think you should take that seriously. This is not acceptable. At least the least that could have happened is, suppose you had met, let's say, once or twice. You could have given minutes of the meeting. This lab crew or this lab batch met on this day. In the absence of any description on the Moodle for project ideas, we discussed the possible projects. We discussed this with our lab TA. This was our consensus. We spent 1.5 hours doing this. This meeting was attended by so many people. Isn't that information about the work that you have done? If you don't report it, it will be assumed that you have done nothing. Please understand. And it has repercussions on evaluation as well, although I don't consider evaluation to be the more important part. But when you work as teams, when you work as groups, it is mandatory that you maintain a record of whatever work that you have done during that day. Please understand what I told you. The biggest problem in these course projects will be handling communication and decision making in groups. Why you call a meeting of 12 people or 13 people who are there in the lab batch, invariably one or two will have some other work, they will not be able to attend. You would have had such meetings earlier. How many of your batches are guaranteeing that every member attended every meeting that was organized? Somebody was upset. Has it been recorded? Sky does not fall on that person's head if that person is not able to attend one meeting or two. But what is important is, suppose I am a member who is not able to attend a meeting called by the team leader. Do I later on my own, approach my team leader and say, what happened in that meeting? If I don't, I am actually being discourteous to the other members of the batch. And I must therefore be punished for this lapse. I must proactively ask, what happened that day? What did you discuss? Have you set up email groups or at least email IDs of all 12 people where one of the three team leaders who becomes some kind of a batch coordinator sends a mail to all members saying this is what was discussed? Now these are non-trivial issues. These are not programming things. This is not setting up file pointer, accessing an index. But without doing these things properly, no programming project in the world has ever successfully been implemented. And I want you, and you will appreciate this, that if you learn this, it will be useful to you, not only during your stay in this institute, but even later. So no compromise with that. If you did not have any meeting held so far, this is your last chance. By today evening, do something and report. Obviously, this report will be a text file. No program is expected to be written. In fact, I don't expect you to write any program even in the next week, barring some trials that people might want to make. But these submissions must happen. Or this week alone, if you don't submit a tar file, it is okay, but some mail must come. So I'm saying for this week report, just send a mail to your lab here and to me. That will be adequate. But from next week, a tar file must go by the deadline of Wednesday. The postponement is only for the stage 1 and stage 2 because of this delay. Is that okay? Thank you.